Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. My name is Ziad, Crohn's disease patient, NHS worker and educator, here bringing you IBD facts and taboo breaking chats. Don't forget to like, comment, share and subscribe to my channel. So let's get started. Hello and welcome to this lesson on what is inflammatory bowel disease. So to give you an overview of what we're going to go through today, we're going to look at the four main types of IBD, and I'm going to give you a description of the subtypes which are found in those four main types, as well as how IBD is classified. So firstly, inflammatory bowel disease is the term used to describe a group of chronic and incurable inflammatory conditions that affect the digestive system. There are four different types of IBD, but most only know of the two main common forms known as Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. Despite there being treatments available to manage symptoms of IBD, there is, however, no cure. So let's have a look at what Crohn's disease is. So Crohn's disease is a lifelong condition where parts of the digestive system become inflamed. It is commonly referred to as Crohn's and can affect any part of the digestive system, but it most commonly affects the terminal ileum and the proximal colon. In Crohn's disease, the lining of the intestines become inflamed, which can cause abscesses and ulcerations to form. This results in hyperemia, which is the increasing of blood supply to an organ, as well as edema, which is swelling caused by excess fluid to occur at the area of inflammation. This leads to the damage and inflammation of the different layers of the intestine, which we covered in the first module. This is known as transmural inflammation, which results in patches of damaged bowel that then have a cobblestone appearance. Interestingly, Crohn's disease got its name from Dr. Burrell Bernard Crohn, who, along with two colleagues, Dr. Leon Ginsberg and Dr. Gordon Oppenheimer, described a group of patients who were suffering from this transmural inflammation of the small and large intestines. Now, depending on which part of the intestines are affected with inflammation will determine the type of Crohn's disease a person has, of which there are six types, and of which more than one type can occur in one person. So the first type is known as oral facial granulomatosis, which is a name given when Crohn's disease affects the mouth and is most likely, despite being rare, to occur in children. Gastroduodenal Crohn's disease is a type of Crohn's that affects the esophagus, stomach, and the duodenum of the small intestine. However, it is not that common and can occur in addition to other parts of the digestive system being affected with Crohn's disease. Small bowel Crohn's disease is when Crohn's occurs in either the jejunum or ileum of the small intestine. And then terminal ileal and ileocecal Crohn's disease is when the last portion of your small intestine, known as the ileum, has Crohn's disease, as well as the portion that connects the small intestine and the large intestine, known as the ileocecal junction, is affected with inflammation. Colonic Crohn's disease is when your large intestine is affected with inflammation. It is sometimes referred to as Crohn's colitis, but it is not the same as ulcerative colitis. And lastly, perianal Crohn's disease, which is one of the most common forms of Crohn's disease, which affects the rectum and the anus. So currently, Crohn's disease is classified based on the Montreal classification system. So this classification system categorizes Crohn's disease based on the age of disease occurred, the location and behavior of the disease that is present. For an in-depth explanation of what the different categories and subcategories actually mean, see your information pack, which is available at the end of this lesson. Next, we're going to look at what ulcerative colitis is. So in ulcerative colitis, it is most commonly the inner lining of the large intestine and the rectum that are affected with inflammation and ulceration. The inflammation seen in ulcerative colitis causes sores, which leads to the bleeding that is seen as a symptom. Now, it is different to Crohn's disease, as ulcerative colitis only affects the large intestine and the inflammation only affects one layer of the intestinal wall. Interestingly and historically, ulcerative colitis predates Crohn's disease, with cases being described as far back to ancient Greek times. However, it wasn't until 1859 when ulcerative colitis was described as a specific disease by Sir Samuel Wilkes. Now, there are four types of ulcerative colitis, which is dependent on which part of the large intestine has inflammation. So the first type is total colitis, when the entire large intestine is affected with inflammation. It is also known as pancolitis. Then there's left-sided colitis, is where the structures located on the left-hand side of the large intestine are inflamed, which include the descending colon and rectum. Then there's proctosigmoiditis, which is where the rectum and sigmoid colon have inflammation. And then lastly, there's proctitis, where in this type, only the rectum, which is the last portion of the large intestine, has inflammation. Now, the Montreal classification is also used to classify ulcerative colitis, but it's only based on extent and severity. Next, we're going to look at microscopic colitis, which is the lesser known type of inflammatory bowel disease. Now, in microscopic colitis, which is another form of IBD, it is not as well known and it also affects the large intestine, but the inflammation can only be seen under a microscope when a biopsy of the intestine is taken during colonoscopy. The main symptom of microscopic colitis is watery diarrhea, as the large intestine is unable to absorb water due to the microscopic inflammation. There are two main types of microscopic colitis. The first type is known as lymphocytic colitis, which is where the inner lining of the large intestine has many of the white blood cells known as lymphocytes, hence the name lymphocytic colitis. The other type is collagenous colitis, which is where there is a thicker amount of collagen on the inner lining of the intestine than normal. And now lastly, we're going to look at indeterminate colitis. So there can be cases where clinicians cannot actually diagnose either Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis, despite the symptoms being present in a person. In this case, a diagnosis of indeterminate colitis is given and is sometimes known as IBD unclassified, which, despite being somewhat controversial, is still a distinct clinical entity. People who are given a diagnosis of IBD unclassified later on get given a diagnosis of either Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis, depending on the progression of their symptoms and disease. So to summarize in this lesson, what we have looked at is what IBD is, the types of IBD, the subtypes of those types of IBD, and how IBD can be classified.